Hello, thanks for joining me. Today we're going to be exploring the menu system of the Sony a6100. Let's go. Thanks for joining me. We are continuing our series on the shooting menu for the Sony 6100. We're going piece by piece through the menu system here. And if this is the first link that you've clicked on, please do note that we have previous videos on the other parts of the shooting menu that we've already covered and on the quick menu. And so please do check those out if you're trying to cover all of the shooting controls in order. Before we jump into it, as always, everything we do here is brought to you by Camera Lessons Online, where we believe in teaching the essential skills so that everybody can create beautiful visual art with cameras and photography equipment. We have a 4-hour introduction to photography class. We have books, we have free downloads. I encourage you to go check it out. But without further ado, here is our continuing exploration of the menu for the Sony 6100.
So let's take a look at page 7. Now, several things in here were covered in the function menu video. Exposure, compensation, ISO, and metering were all covered there. And so we're not going to spend time on those, but we are going to look at face priority in multi-segmented metering. We're going to take a look at the exposure steps. We're going to take a look at auto exposure with shutter. So let's go into this. So face priority in multi-metering. Now, multi-metering is the metering mode. It's the wide area that it defaults in. Multi-segmented metering is the full term that Sony likes to use. And this is saying, in multi-segmented metering, do we prioritize the metering off of faces with face detection turned on, or do we not? Do we just do it generically off of the scene and not putting greater emphasis on people's faces? If people are the predominant subject matter in your shot, I would leave this on. If people are just part of the landscape, yeah, go ahead and leave it off. It depends on the scene as you see it. Of course, if you shoot in manual mode, it doesn't really matter. All right, so exposure step is for the actual camera. Are we adjusting in third stop increments or half stop increments? Third stop increments, there are more of them, and that means that there's more clicks to a dial, but you have more discretion. I always use third stop increments. I never set any piece of equipment from lighting to cameras to half stop increments. I actually once owned a series of flashes that only operated in half stop increments, and it was super frustrating, because I could not actually set with any precision the exposure I wanted on a subject. So anyway, since your metering system also works with lighting equipment and it also gives you greater control, I would always leave this in third stop increments, personally, at least. So last is auto exposure lock with the shutter. And this is something that's very rarely touched, and it's, does the shutter button engage locking the exposure? So auto is going to, does it need to engage or does it not? It makes a decision for you. Always locking the exposure is on, and never locking exposure is, of course, off. Not something that I've ever really worried about personally, because I try to get people into manual exposure mode where you can always adjust exposure with the camera and always kind of want to. But when you go to shoot, do you start the shutter button, hold it halfway down, and then change exposure? That's the only time this would make a difference in your life. All right, let's go to page 8. And now we're moving into flash options. And so some of these, again, are going to be part of the function menu. So this first one, flash mode, we're not going to get into because it is in the function menu. But flash compensation, exposure compensation set, wireless flash, and red eye reduction, we're going to talk about those. So flash compensation is actually super simple. It's when you want to change the brightness of the flash, either the one that is on camera or an auxiliary flash attached to the camera, including through wireless controllers. This is where you would easily, in a TTL flash mode, change the brightness of that flash or those flashes. So exposure compensation set is asking the question of, when you change exposure compensation, does it just change the ambient exposure? And that would be aperture, shutter speed, ISO. Or does it also have permission to change flash output so that it changes the exposure on the lit subject? Now, I'm not a big fan of shooting flash exposures in a non-manual mode because, by definition, if you shoot a flash exposure in shutter priority or aperture priority, the camera has to average the ambient exposure with the flash exposure. And so if I was shooting in a non-manual mode, I would have this set to ambient only. That would give me a control over my ambient exposure without touching the flash exposure, and I could move flash compensation to match. But if I'm shooting in a manual mode, I might want to have this set for flash and ambient because I could use exposure compensation just to move flash, because in manual, moving exposure compensation does not change aperture, shutter, or ISO. Now, I don't have a flash attached to the camera at this moment, and so wireless flash doesn't work. It says, hey, you can't actually use wireless with the built-in flash of this device. You must have some kind of either external flash or the C1 Commander or some other type of device to operate, and that tells the flash to actually send out a wireless signal. So if you have the F32, the F45, the F60M flashes, then this is turning on your wireless capability with that particular unit, and specifically the optical slave triggering mechanism of that flash, all right? If you have a C1 Commander, you can turn on radio frequency on an F45 on the unit to receive it, but that would be off camera. So that's where we turn on wireless. Just know it does not work with built-in flashes in the Sony system. Interestingly, back when they made A-mount cameras, the built-in flash was a triggering flash. When they made it smaller to go onto the 6 series cameras, they couldn't fit the wireless capability inside of them. And so that dropped off of their options. So red eye reduction is next. And this is just basically a feature with flash that you can turn on and off. And what's key about it is understand how it works. Red eye flash strobes the flash a little bit before the actual exposure. It does that to constrict the pupil in the eye, and that way you reduce, thus the reduction, the likelihood of recording red eye. That's what it works and how it does. So it actually takes a little bit longer. It strobes the flash and then fires the picture. That's how red eye works. Be careful that you don't just leave this on all the time. It's perfectly possible for people to see the strobing of the flash, think the picture's taken, start to walk away, and then the picture fires, and you're not actually getting that critical moment that you wanted with the flash. And red eye reduction flash will work with built-in flash on the A6100, no problem. All right, so let's get into color. And the first thing is white balance. And white balance is covered in the function menu, so we're not going to get into that. But we are going to take a look at some of these other options. So priority set in auto white balance is going to be one we're going to get to here in a second. I'm just going to switch this to auto real fast. Okay. All right. So the question here is auto white balance attempting to make a perfect white inside of the frame? Or is it trying to still give a little bit of the impression of the color of the room, which is ambiance? If it tries to make its own decision, that's standard, is effectively what it is. And so as I kind of scroll here, you should see a difference from the white in that alpha logo as I go back and forth. So that's going for pure white in the auto. Now, DRO is Dynamic Range Optimizer, and this is where you're going to find the auto enhancement, that's DRO, and also where you're going to find the HDR merge inside of camera. So DRO off does no auto enhancement. We obviously have different levels of your auto enhancement, your DRO, and this is where HDR shooting is going to be. HDR is going to shoot a couple pictures, merge them together. You will get a lot more latitude in merging images if you shoot them with a bracketed series and then merge them in software later on. But you can do a very basic one here in camera. And all you get to choose is the amount of difference between the images in stops. So it started at about 1 stop exposure. And we can crank that up here. And the greater the difference, the little bit more cartoony it will effectively be. But you can work with a greater disparity between bright and dark areas. All right, so let's go down to creative style here. So here's where we're going to find basic way of processing the image. And this is something that will come out in the image as you're taking a look at it. They've actually removed neutral from the camera, which I found to be a very interesting option, but we can easily turn portrait into neutral effectively. And you can adjust these. So this is how's the camera actually saving the image. So standard, vivid, portrait, landscape. There's a couple others below it. Sunset, I believe that black and white's the last one. Yeah. So if I go into one of these, I actually get three choices in how the camera processes. That's what you were seeing there at the bottom. It's contrast, it's saturation, and what's called sharpening. I do go into a little bit of depth on that in the function menu video, so do check that out. Now, one thing not covered in the function menu video is this next option here. And this is where we have creative effects. Now, these can only be JPEG images, but we get some kind of fun kind of toys to play with here. So we've got made the camera look like a toy camera, posterization, pop color. Next one's a retro feel here. You're going to get soft high key lighting. You do get partial black and whites, red, blue, green, and red. So red, green, blue, and yellow, sorry. Where it only uses that color and then everything else is black and white. High contrast black and white, soft mid tones. You get a painting look, which I've actually played with and think it's a lot of fun. Watercolor look, which is actually a lot of fun, and illustration. And so I'd play with those. They're a lot of fun. Those are called the picture effects, as opposed to creative style. Creative style is used for more standardized shooting, just the way the camera processes the image. Picture effects are actual like processing done to the image. So next is soft skin effect. It actually does go through and do a little bit of blurring to try to get rid of wrinkles and imperfections in skin. So that's actually what that feature is there. Notice that it said, hey, you're in continuous shooting mode. We can't do it because it has to process every image. So this is a portrait only type of shot for you to go into. So we're going to go into single shooting then and take a look at this feature. And we do have arrows left and right, which means we get to decide the amount of this particular effect. And I want you to be careful with it, because if you go low, medium, and then high, and you go to high for everything, you start making people look like they're made out of plastic. So I would be very light touch with this effect, but it can be flattering for folks, which is nice. People like that. So next is our focus magnifier. Here we're on page 10, and this is where it will jump into the frame to allow you to check critical focus, even in autofocus mode, but there is a caveat to it, and it's grayed out right now. So if I click on that, I'm going to see that I can't do it in continuous focusing mode. I've got to be in single focusing mode to let it do this magnification so I can check critical focus. So we're going to go ahead and change our focusing mode here. Go into our quick menu, change it to AFS, back in. And now I can actually tell where in the frame I want to check focus on. Some people will set this as a button on their camera so they can pop into the frame, really take a look at what they want to focus on, make sure it's in critical sharpness, and then jump out to make sure that they get the shot that they want, which is a very useful trick, especially for landscape images or night sky images, particularly after sunset. So there, I'm taking a look at it, and it was not perfectly in focus to me. Now, magnifying time, just how long it looks at this when you're actually checking critical focus. So it defaults to 2 seconds out of the box. Let's see, if I move this back to the center, I can do 2 seconds, 5 seconds, or no limit is basically until I press another button. So initial focus magnification, how far in do we go? A little bit or a lot? 1 times or 5.9 times. So autofocus when you are magnifying is going to be our next option. And when this is on, if you're magnifying, you can still autofocus, and it will allow you to choose focus on an area even smaller than the crosshairs is able to show you on the full screen, which is very, very cool. Manual focus assist. Now, this has been in Sony cameras for a while and has a lot of people who love it. Let's turn this back off here. So I default it back to the way that it was. Let's go to the manual focus option. Okay, manual focus assist, on and off. This is where in manual focus, It zooms into the picture to allow you to do manual focus to make sure that you get critical sharpness on the subject you care about. And if you're shooting stills, particularly non-moving stills, it's super accurate. If you're shooting video, I would turn this off because you lose the ability to frame the shot. So some people like it, some people don't, and I think your shooting circumstance matters. So now let's get into focus peaking. If you're not using manual focus assist, I would most definitely be using focus peaking. This highlights an area of the frame in focus with a color of your choice. So it only shows up in manual focus, by the way. So I leave this on full time, but it only shows up in manual focus. So peaking display off and on, that's actually turning the feature on. Level is how sensitive it is to the area in focus. I never set this to high. I'm mid or low always. Low doesn't always necessarily highlight my subject, and so mid can be a good halfway point. Peaking color, what color does it show up in? Some people are colorblind to a certain color, and sometimes you might be shooting a picture of something that's blue, and so a blue peaking color would be useless. So red, yellow, blue, white are your options. And actually, they only added blue in very recent camera releases. So that's actually a new feature, that particular color, at least. So face registration is next. And face registration is where the camera remembers what somebody looks like. So to do this, we go into the feature, we go to new registration, it gives you a little box, have them just look right at you, put their face inside of the box, shoot a picture. It will remember them. And then when face detection is turned on, it can pick them out of a crowd to focus on, which is really nice when you're taking your family on vacation. If you are shooting some kind of an event, such as a wedding, you can change the order of importance because there are 12 registers. Order exchange is changing the order of importance because if it sees three people that it knows, it will pick them in order of importance. You can delete an individual or delete the entire cache. So lots of uses for face registration, both for pros and for family photographers. You better believe my whole family is registered on my cameras. Okay. Do the faces have priority? In families, we typically say no. For shooting events, we typically say yes. So we get a choice on that. We didn't used to, actually. Now, smile shutter is interesting. If you've never used it, you should completely play with it. It's fun. The camera will snap the picture for you if the person it's looking at smiles. And this can be great if you don't have anybody to shoot your picture if you're on vacation. And so you can use this to be your photographer if you want. It's also fun to turn this on if you're shooting pictures anyway of kids and you look away for a second and the kid smiles and you would have got the picture. Auto object framing is something that Sony has got a lot of heat on, because it would defaulted to on with their A6000 out of the box, and people typically hate this feature. What it does is you shoot a picture. If it sees a person, it will not only save the image as you shot it, but then crop it to a standard portrait framing. So that's the auto object framing portion of it, and save that cropped image as a second shot. I've had more people complain about this than any other Sony feature. It's now defaulted off in their cameras, where it previously was defaulted on. So I had a lot of people who disliked this. If you want to have just an automatic, way for the camera to just make a portrait shot for you, turn it on. It actually does a reasonable job of the crop. It just confused a lot of my customers over time. All right, so the next one is there a self-timer going on with a self-portrait? So if it sees that you're basically using the camera to shoot a picture of yourself, because you flip the screen up, does it then give you a timer so that you know when to smile? This is actually useful. So this is kind of a nice little selfie thing. So let's go into it here. And so it's just an on and an off thing. And it just gives you a little 3-second timer when you're doing a selfie. So fun little thing that they gave you just to make everything convenient. So that is the end of the shooting menu, the main shooting menu. We will be exploring the second page of the shooting menu in later videos. Thank you for watching.